aspects of the vehicle, there are three important stiffnesses that you have to understand. What are the three important stiffnesses? That is what is the understandings of lattice plot. I would say what is the lattice plot and so on. Before that, let us understand the requirement of tire for ride. So, you know, the tire basic function is not only to support the weight of the vehicle, also to provide three important aspects. One is to account the energy transferred, the force transferred due to undulation. So vibration isolation, it should provide a good cushion between the road and the vehicle. So that is what is ride aspects. It has to provide good traction and braking effort. That's what is your performance aspect. It has to provide adequate lateral force and steering control and so on. That's what is taking care of your handling aspects. So these are all the basic requirement of a tire. So when you look at the tire basic requirement for ride is concerned, we need to understand three important stiffnesses of the tire. One is what is called the static stiffness. Another one is what is called non-rolling dynamic stiffness. Non-rolling. Tire is not rolling. There is a dynamic stiffness. And rolling dynamic stiffness. Dynamic stiffness, right? So these are the things you should understand. So now here you see this lattice plot is the load deflection curve plotted for the tire under static condition. So what do you mean by that? You have your tire kept on a rig and it is on the flat surface and you are started loading the tire. So if you take there are a number of inclined lines and there are number of lines goes in this fashion also. So look at these lines. So these lines, if you look at, this is for 15 psi, 20 psi, 26 psi and so on, 25, 30. So as the inflation pressure increases, these lines are slightly increases with their slope. So, or you can say there is a linear portion of this line and that is what is its static stiffness. So what is basically these lines? So if I choose one particular inflation pressure, say 35 psi, if I look at only this line alone, this is variation of load versus deflection. So it is going to be progressively. If I increase the load, my tire also going to deflect more and more. So you see when zero load, zero deflection. So it keeps increasing. And this is the line. So if I reduce my inflation pressure and if I do it again, say there is a shift in this curve. It is not from zero. So you would see that as an increase of decrease of inflation pressure, you would see that there is a deflection because of self weight. Or it is not a zero. So if I completely remove my load, it is not coming to zero. So there is some value here. So the shift is there. That's an important observation here. And also the this can be also looked at for a given deflection. What is the required inflation and the load? So if it is 51 mm is the required deflection, you see that this graph here, this line. Refer to what as this is the deflection to be maintained, you require not only to increase the load, also to increase the inflation pressure. That's the meaning. So I have to do control of my load as well as inflation pressure to maintain my deflection. So take any line. So this 20.3 mm deflection to have, I require not only to increase the load, also to increase my inflation pressure. See, here it is 15 psi, here it is 20 psi, so and so on. So I have to have a control of both load as well as inflation pressure. So this you would experience whenever you are trying to model your tire in finite element analysis or finite element software. So if you look at an Abaqus software, you have a dedicated module for this tire mechanics simulation. So you see the tire models readily available. So the first step in tire model is the given finite element model of the tire, the section to be inflated and loaded, And then the result, what you get for the section, you will revolve around the 360 degrees to get your tire model, wherein it is inflated and loaded for the required amount of your simulation. So the control of this loading and inflation pressure simultaneously, that is what you would see. So for a required deflection, I fix my deflection, I require both to adjust. So that is all to be brought in one graph or one plot is what is called a lattice plot. And one I have used to describe is for bias ply tire. Whereas you see the same on a radial ply tire. Radial ply tire, you have the slope is different. That means what the static for a bias ply tire, if I take for 15 psi, the same 15 psi if I see, this slope is lesser than that of this slope. That means the static deflection of radial ply tire is smaller than that of bias ply tire. Like that, you can just do a comparison. What is very important is leave the lower loads. Take the moderate load and the intermediate, this zone to this zone. So you see these all are straight, almost linear. So you would see that the static stiffness can be constant, you can assume, right? And this, the variation is very less here, as well as here you can approximate. So that is going to be in the smaller region, going to be constant or independent of load, you can say. Because for the chosen load, you have a slope constant, only inflation pressure do come in the picture. So the static stiffness is independent of the load, as the slope is constant there, right? So this is what is one of the stiffness. Another one is called non-rolling dynamic stiffness. So that is why here you see, before going to there, that's why you see here for this passenger car 165 by 13, this is width and this is rim size in inches. You see static deflection is taken as constant here, right? For a radial ply car tire. This is an example. And again, rolling dynamic stiffness. Before going to rolling dynamic stiffness, what is non-rolling dynamic stiffness? Let us understand. What is non-rolling dynamic stiffness? So non-rolling dynamic stiffness test is done by drop test. So what do you mean by drop test? So drop test is the one, it's not having your tire wheel assembly from 1 meter from the surface and then you drop it and then what's happening? No. So tire is inflated with the rated inflation pressure, or particular, like you have seen in a parametric study of varying inflation pressure. So you choose an inflation pressure of the tire and then you are just holding it, just touching the surface of the tire. So you would have your setup of the tire wheel assembly hung so that the tire is just touching or just about to touch the road surface of the flat surface of the bed. And then suddenly you release the tire constraint so that it is going to sit on it. That's a drop test. So such test is done, there will be a response that you would measure. And that response is what is going to help you to define non-rolling dynamic stiffness of the tire. And that response is typically going to be how it's going to be a transient response. So the transient response means I would have my amplitude decayed. So I would have my amplitude exponentially decaying like this. So such kind of response I'll get out of this drop test. Where this drop test is done, where this is not touching here, you'll have your complete tire, no contact. And this is just made to fall on this with the required load. And there will be a transient response because of it. It is not dropping the tire wheel from some finite height and then seeing. That is drop test for maybe crash purpose and all to study. Or severity of falling on pit and all to study. That we are not doing it. This drop test is like this inflated tire is just to be seated on this freely. And because of the load acting on that, you would see there will be suddenly it's falling on this. there will be a transient response, and that transient response amplitude would be decayed, and then it will settle at some value. So this kind of response would be quite useful, because this is free response, and this free vibrational theory that we are studied in vibrational course would help us to calculate an important property of your tire, which is visco damping characteristic, damping property of the tire. So what is this? It's a damping value. So damping can be calculated. Actually, this tire material is such that it's neither Coulomb damping nor complete viscous damping. It is combination. That's why we write it as an equivalent damping, equivalent visco elastic material. So this tire would be always represented in your vehicle dynamic simulation with its mass, tire wheel assembly, with the elasticity by the tire stiffness, and by the equivalent damping value, and this is KTR, and this would go and sit on the road undulation. Like that, it would take for the tire to do single degree damped free vibration response would help us to calculate this, which would have its natural frequency called damped natural frequency given by 2 pi by time period tau. This is all that you know. Right, and you could calculate the CQ if you know your ratio of amplitude given by the logarithmic decrement delta L and X1 by X2, where X1 is say this amplitude is X1, this amplitude is X2. So I have this ratio, natural logarithm is what is giving me something called a logarithmic decrement. And this logarithmic decrement, if I have, I would be able to express my CEQ. CEQ will be given by this expression. 4 times m squared WD square delta square divided by delta square plus 4 pi square. You could see this from the classical vibration book, divided by, this is all within radical, this is all divided by, I would have here 1 minus delta square by delta square plus 4 pi whole square. So this is what is an equivalent damping value of the tire. You would see in the textbook you have for various tire dimensions, bias tire and radial tire, the CEQ values are given tabulated for ready use of this. So the drop test is basically done for what? To characterize the values of your CEQ. This static stiffness value is done for to have your KTR. So it is also proven or observation that if I have my static stiffness 20 to 30% less than the static stiffness, if I take, I would have my dynamic stiffness. What is that? Thirdly, we are going to see. In the case of truck tires, it is 5% less than that of static stiffness of the tire. So if that is why this experiment, static stiffness measurement experiment, or the lattice plot are very popular. If I know the values from the lattice plot, I would appropriately take what would be my dynamic stiffness. What do you mean by dynamic stiffness? Dynamic stiffness is function of your speed. That's what you would see now in a next slide. So rolling dynamic stiffness, if you look at, see here, I have two plots. So in this plot, I have different car tires here. So you can see one is with the bias ply, another radial ply, and a special radial ply. So these three on a test rig, the drum diameter generally of 2.5 meter drum, and this is my tire where this rolling takes place to vary the speed. So as the low speeds, you see at low speeds, you see there is peak drop in your dynamic stiffness value, but after which it is almost independent of your speed. So this drop is what is, if you are accommodating 20 to 30% from its static stiffness, what you have calculated. That's what is that its nature. So you see that it's again with two different pressure condition. One is for 245 kilopascal, another one is for 147 kilopascal. So 245 kilopascal, you have your dynamic stiffness is more. Whereas 145 kilopascal, you have your same tire dynamic stiffness is less. So the dynamic stiffness is more depending on an inflation pressure rather than the load. Right? Why is it not writing? Rather than the load. Okay. What has happened to this? Inflation pressure. Yeah. Yeah, please.
Same dynamic stiffness is much more than the if dynamic stiffness is constantly very high, then won't it affect the what we can say the tire side walls? Won't they get elongated and just rupture somewhat?
No. Tire side wall stiffness is different. Tire side wall stiffness is different. This is here as you have your tire and it is flexing, the sidewall spring is what is like acting as your stiffness here, and that stiffness is going to be function of what we are looking at it in static load curve. You have seen that. Why is this not writing? This suddenly stopped working. My 1 minute. Not writing. Is it this point?
I mean to say that if dynamic stiffness depends upon the inflation pressure, right? But inflation pressure is directly proportional to the elongation or the expansion of the tire.
Yeah. What I'm elongation is expansion. 1 minute. What do you mean by elongation and expansion? It's only one. It is expanding, right? If you are inflating, tire expand.
Yes, sir. If inflation pressure is rising, then the tire expands. But I'm saying that if we continuously increase the inflation pressure, which indirectly expands the tire, then won't be...
That is increasing the stiffness of the tire. That is increasing the stiffness of the tire. The stiffness only we look at in three ways. One is static stiffness, non-rolling stiffness and rolling stiffness for the ride aspect is concerned. Ride aspect is concerned, right? So this stiffness is not something, I understand, you know that very clearly, everyone. This stiffness is not the stiffness what we looked at in traction or in our string model. This stiffness is for your vertical stiffness of the tire. So that is what is pronounced or drawn by your this graph. So in this graph, our observation is it is going to be more function of inflation pressure rather than the load. That's why we take a static stiffness as simple load versus inflation pressure. Right? See, as the inflation pressure varies here. What is this is for a increase in inflation pressure, you have your stiffness value increases or not. Increases. That's what is that is understood. See this graph carefully. The slope of this is not a stiffness. Don't misunderstand. This plot is for load versus deflection. Load versus deflection. The slope here is what is stiffness. And that stiffness is independent of load. It's not. If I take load increases, the slope is same. Load increases, slope is same. Load increases, the slope is same for the given inflation pressure. But what is happening as the inflation pressure increases, the stiffness value is increasing. It is function of inflation pressure. That's why we have drawn this. The static stiffness value increases linearly as an inflation pressure increases. So I would have for my car tire of 200 kPa or say 25 psi will have one stiffness value, whereas the same will be different at 35 psi. So if you have understood this, now dynamic stiffness, when you look at it, you see dynamic stiffness as function of speed, you have to look at it. So when you look at that, that is more pronounced. The dynamic stiffness falls so much, reduces only at the low speeds. Look at here at the low speeds, it is reduces. Whereas here it is not so. Beyond this 5 kilometers per hour also, the dynamic stiffness is constant. It is independent of speed. Similarly, here also, but it is function of inflation pressure. That's what I'm saying. So on the experimental observation, based on that, it is recommended that you are going to look at your actual dynamic stiffness of your tire can be taken 20% less in case of a passenger car tire, whereas 5% in case of a truck tire. That's one recommendation. But how are these rolling tire dynamic stiffness are determined? How are they different from static stiffness determination and non-rolling tire determination is what you have to understand. For this, what is that commonly done is, in the tire contact patch, there is a harmonic excitation given, and that harmonic excitation input, what is the output at the hub of the tire is measured. So the transmissibility function is what is used to define this dynamic stiffness. And that dynamic stiffness observation is what is independent of speed beyond some certain speed, whereas at low speed it falls down. That is why you take this dynamic stiffness value is of some percentage less. So on this dump test, when it is done, these plots are made for the response obtained at the hub for the given harmonic excitation at the tread. Okay, now you ask any doubts for them. If no doubts, let me just to proceed for another two slides and complete. So again, you see here dynamic stiffness is function of inflation pressure. Again, you see here my the stylus stopped working. I need to find out. So inflation pressure, you see here increases. You see your stiffness value also increases. Right, as the pressure value increases, stiffness value also increases. The slope of this should not be looked at it. That's not our worry. Instead, you should look at that variation is linear. As I increase my inflation pressure, my stiffness value increases linearly. Like that, you should look at it. And it is function of speed. So look at, as I have a speed here more, I would have my stiffness value in the lower line. Compared to the dump, 1 kilometers per hour here given by this line, right? So again, since this variation, these are all like a concentric with a constant offset line almost, you would have your dynamic stiffness is independent of the speed after some particular speed. For 5 kilometers per hour onwards, it's bunched together here. So that is the effect of inflation pressure on rolling dynamic stiffness at various speeds. And the same you could see for the case of a dynamic coefficient, damping coefficient, influence of damping, speed on damping coefficient of a radial ply truck tire. You could see that damping coefficient appears to increase at the low speeds, but as your speed increases, it comes asymptotic. So it's of truck tire. So if you are driving truck with a 30-40 kilometers per hour speed, you would have your damping coefficient value taken to be constant. That's why you have a table data with the damping coefficient value. The constant value you can take and do a dynamic simulation. But whenever it is of low speed, at the beginning you start your truck and then you are varying or coming to a cruising speed of some 20 kilometers per hour, you see there is a substantial variation in your damping, and that variation in damping do affect your cushioning of your vehicle from the road excitation. So that's all very important. So in your vehicle dynamic simulation, you have to have your tire model. You require the value of damping, you require value of stiffness. And simplest model of your tire is, it is described as by a lumped single mass and spring and damper kept parallelly, right? So this value of stiffness of the tire and the damping coefficient of the tire are listed for radial and bias ply tire for trucks. More information available on the Wong textbook. You can look at, there are tables at the end of the first chapter. And you see this graphs again, comparison of bias ply tire and radial ply tire, acceleration measured at the hub. You can see for the excitation given. So what is the axial acceleration in G, RMS acceleration? If you look at it, is bias ply tire has got its influence at the lower frequency range, whereas radial ply tire varies from 60 to 100 dominant than this. And again, you see beyond this 150 to 100, you see bias ply tire has got more compared to the tub radial tire. So bias ply tire acceleration more means you would have here in this frequency range, this energy in terms of vibration measured are more pronouncing of noise phenomena more. So bias ply tire is more noisier than that of a radial tires because the noise is more witnessed in this frequency range. In this frequency range of till 40 hertz, it is vibration phenomena. So again, you see bias tires are not good for vibration point of view. So radial tires are better. But however, radial tire has got this mid frequency range from 60 to 100 hertz dominant than the bias ply tire. So this zone is where there is a compromise, which is going to have a transition between vibrational aspect as well as noise aspect. So people do work on this, but when it is pure vibration point, it is taken care, and noise point also is taken care at this cost. So that's why radial ply tire is better for NVH aspects compared to the bias ply tire. And similarly, this is again a transmissibility ratio. What do you mean by transmissibility ratio? It is the output of at the hub by input at the road. So you see here comparison between bias ply and radial ply, and the ratio is what is plotted here. This what is that deviation. So the deviation is plotted like radial ply to bias ply for every frequency. So you see wherever it's greater than one, what do you mean by that? It is radial ply to this. Greater than one means you see the transmissibility is more in a radial tire compared to the bias ply. That's the meaning. So whenever it less than one, it is good. So this frequency ranges, it is less than one. In this frequency range, it is greater than one. Radial ply tire. What is that here also witness? Same way here. So this is the kind of plot which is required to be looked at when you are saying vibrational aspect of your tire. What is the cushioning that is being provided by your tire? Such kind of results are coming because of your tire stiffness and damping value, you can say, or such type of plots are plotted in a test rig for an harmonic excitation, wherein you are able to have dynamic stiffness determined. And the one what we see non-rolling dynamic stiffness helps us to quantify the equivalent damping value, the static stiffness value from the lattice plot. So these all are important experiments conducted on a test rig for the tires to characterize them for the ride aspects of your vehicle. And these are some of the additional data as far as noise level is concerned. They are influenced based on the tire construction. So if it is a bias lug tire means you'll have transverse grooves, buttons will be there like that. Rib tires means it will be only the grooves, circumferential grooves. So you have radial, these are the varieties of different tires and the noise level in decibel A weighted. We'll see what are A weighting and so on later. As a function of speed. So as the speed increases, you would have your noise level increases irrespective of the type of tire. Maybe bias lug tire is not preferred as they are more noisier tire compared to that of radial tires. That's what you would conclude from this observation graph. And there's a table for a different road surface. What is the noise level of a particular bias ply truck tire chosen? So smooth concrete, you have 70 dBA compared to the depth of brushed concrete. So brushed concrete is having to have passage for the water to go away. So maybe brushed concrete is necessary to channelize your water depth to avoid hydroplaning, but the compromise of more noisier. So in highway, if you go asphalt suddenly on a concrete road, you would see there is more noisier, correct? So moderately smooth concrete, if we take it is less. So similarly, smooth asphalt, you see 72 and worn concrete exposed aggravate 72. So these are all some of the standard observation through the experimental result published for a particular case of a bias ply truck tire. Like this, these are some samples. So when you say the tires for the ride aspects, it has to account vibrational behavior as well as noise behavior in your vehicle, in short, to make it. So that characteristics, when you look at the stiffness and damping value of the tire, is important, and they will be appropriately used in a mathematical model to quantify mathematically in a vehicle level, in a vehicle dynamic simulation studies. So with that, I would stop today's lecture. And if you have any doubts, I'm happy to answer. And this completes our first module. And as we have said, we will look at on tomorrow evening one period, 7 to 8, on Wednesday two periods, three periods, module 2, where we are going to look at longitudinal dynamics of a vehicle. We are going to look at free body diagram at a vehicle level instead of looking at tire so far what we have done. So that's all for today's lecture. And let me share.